clearly visible and audible to you people. You have to give me few seconds to confirm whether visibility or hospitability, visibility and audibility is good or not. Just give me a few seconds. Let me see. So I hope it is clearly visible and audible to you people. So let me start the lecture ahead. So I welcome you all for today's session. I am Dr. Priyanka Sachdev here, and today I am here to continue my video on virology. So in virology, we have already covered DNA viruses. So the recordings are available. Those who have missed, they can watch the recordings. And today I am here to start the RNA viruses. So we have seen viruses are of two types, as we already know, DNA and RNA viruses. DNA viruses are only six types. Only of six types. There is a mnemonic for it: double H, A, triple P. So hepadna, herpes, adeno, parvo, papova, and pox. So only six viruses are DNA viruses, and we have completed all of them. Now I am starting with RNA viruses. Here you can see DNA viruses. These are the six DNA viruses which we have already completed. You know, among the DNA, which is the smallest? It is parvo. Which is the largest? It is pox. You know which of them are enveloped, which of them are non-enveloped? Here you can see these three are enveloped. You can find an envelope around them. That is pox, herpes, and hepadna. And pap, the mnemonic is pap. Parvo, papova, and adeno. These three are non-enveloped. You can see no envelope around them. Non-enveloped. So you should know the smallest. You should know the largest. You should know the envelope. You should know the non-enveloped. In all of them, they have DNA as double-stranded DNA. Only one of them is having single-stranded DNA. And it is parvo. Parvo is having single-stranded DNA. So you should know about it. We have completed their details. Now, I am coming on RNA viruses. So this is the list of important RNA viruses. We will not study all of them. We will study only important of them. So let me see which of them are there. So let me see. It is picornavirus, herpes virus, calcivirus, reovirus, flavi, toga, retro, orthomyxo, paramyxo, rhabdo, phylo, corona, arena, bunya, and delta. Okay, we will frame a mnemonic for it. So it is A, B, C, D. You know, it is A, B, C, D, double F, phylo and flavo, double F, double R. That is rhabdo and rio and retro, triple R, double F, triple R. And it is orthomyxo, paramyxo. You can learn like this. And it is PHC. PHCT. So the mnemonic is like this, I guess. It is A, B, C, D, double F, F2, double F, triple R, R3. It is PHC. PB, there are 2P and OT, orthomyxo and toga. So these are the RNA viruses. From them, we will study only important ones. Only important ones. So we will start them one by one. Among them, you can see which is the smallest and which is the largest. So it is picorna, which is the smallest. And paramyxo, it is the largest. So you should know the smallest one. You should know the largest one. You should know which of them are capsulated and which of them are non-capsulated. So all of them are capsulated except three. Which three are non-capsulated? These are the three which are non-capsulated. Let me show you the names of non-capsulated one. These are not capsulated, not enveloped. So picorna, calci, and rio, PCR. These are non-enveloped. These are non-enveloped. Picorna, calci, and rio. And among them, four is having segmented RNA. The mnemonic is BORA, B-O-R-A, bunya, orthomyxo, rio, and arena. So you should know which is smallest, which is largest, which is having segmented RNA, which are enveloped, which are non-enveloped. You should have a basic of this. So I'm starting the first RNA today, that is picorna virus. Are you people there? Give me a thumbs up. Are you people there? Can we start? Can we start ahead? Okay. Okay, so I'm starting with picorna viridi. So in picorna viridi, I will teach you only important ones. So I will teach you four or five RNA viruses. I will teach you picorna, orthomyxo, paramyxo, rhabdovirus, rabies virus, picorna mein polio aa jayega, and retrovirus, that is HIV. So these five are most important among this list, among this big list. The most five important are picorna. Herpes is also important, you can say. Retro is important, orthomyxo, paramyxo, and rhabdo. These one are important. So I will teach you only these one. I'm starting with the first one, picorna. I hope you people are with me. So picorna virus. We are starting picorna virus. This is picorna virus. Picorna virus size, don't learn the size. genome, it is having single-stranded RNA. All of them have single-stranded RNA, except reovirus, which is having double-stranded RNA. All of them have single-stranded RNA. It has four proteins, B1, BP1, BP2, BP3, BP4. Four proteins are present in the capsid. These are the antigenic proteins, you should learn. These four proteins are present in the capsid. Envelope, it is non-enveloped virus. And replication takes place in the cytoplasm. So that is the basic morphology. Classification, you should learn the classification. Picorna virus is the family. Polio virus is one of the virus of this family. So picorna virus has two types of viruses, enterovirus and rhinovirus, based on whether it is acid resistant or acid sensitive. So enterovirus are acid resistant and rhinovirus is acid sensitive. Enterovirus are of four types: poliovirus, coxsackie virus, ecovirus and enterovirus. Enterovirus 70 and 72. These are the four types of enterovirus. From them we will study only poliovirus. And rhinovirus is the most common virus which cause common cold. That is the most common infection in human beings, you know. So I'm starting with poliovirus, which is a type of picornavirus. It is a type of enterovirus of picornavirus. So picornavirus mein, enterovirus mein poliovirus aata hai. You should know the classification. So poliovirus, I'm starting with poliovirus. So this is the morphology you can see. This is the diagram of poliovirus. In the poliovirus, you can see the nucleic acid is single-stranded RNA. Can you see? It is single-stranded RNA. It is surrounded by capsid. This is capsid. Capsid is made up of capsomer. Capsid is made up of four proteins. Capsid is a protein, na? V1, V2, V3, V4. There are four proteins, V1, V2, V3, V4. These are the four proteins present in the capsid. It is having a single-stranded RNA and capsomer is there. It is capsomer. There are three types of poliovirus: type 1, type 2, type 3. You have to learn. Based on the antigenic properties, there are three types. P1 is most common virus which cause epidemics. P2 is most antigenic and easily eradicable. It is easily eradicable. And P3 is the most common cause of VAPP. You know what is VAPP? It is vaccine associated paralytic polio. You know, we make vaccine from P1, P2, P3. Vaccine, you know, there are two types of vaccines for polio virus. Oral and injectable. That is OPV and IPV. OPV and IPV, that is Sark and Sabin. There are two types of vaccine, na? In both of them, P1, P2, P3, all of them are present. So in live one, if the P3 is live, P1, P2, P3, they are live, but they are attenuated. They are live, but they are attenuated. Still, one in million chance, it can cause polio. It can cause polio because it is live. So instead of preventing polio, because of vaccine, patient can have polio. So it is a very, very dangerous, you know, vaccine associated paralytic polio can occur very, very rarely. 1 per million is the chance, but it can occur due to P3. So what is the basic properties of P1, P2, P3? So P1 is the most common cause of epidemic. P2 is most antigenic and most easily eradicable. And P3 is the most common cause of VAPP. Three most important MCQs, which are asked repeatedly either in microbiology or in PSM. You should learn it. You should learn three MCQs. Done. Pathogenesis. Now, the virus is present either in feces or it is present in the throat. It is present in the droplets. Droplets. So there are two ways of infection. There are two ways. Either picoral route. So virus is excreted in the feces. The feces will contaminate the food water, and the contaminated food water is consumed by another person. So virus is going from one person to another person, that is pico-oral route. So feces of one person to oral of mouth of another person. So that is due to contamination. This is the most common route in developing countries. Second most common route is droplet infection, like it is in COVID, like in tuberculosis, droplet infection. So it occurs in developed countries when one person is having polio. So during initial phase, when one person, just suppose this person is infected by polio virus. So during initial phase, in the secretions, in the droplet of this person, the virus is coming out and it can infect another person. It can infect, so that is droplet infection. You know, droplet infection. So droplet, it is more common route in developed countries. So two routes are there, fecal-oral and droplet. Fecal-oral and droplet. Done, you should know it. So feces and oropharyngeal secretions, that is droplet. Here, reservoir is only man. There is no carrier, only reservoir is there. Age group is 6 months to 3 years. Most of the patients are children. It occurs mostly from 6 months to 3 years of age. Ke patients mein, population, it affects that population. Male preponderance, it occurs more commonly in males. Polio occurs more commonly in males. Done. Now, subclinical cases are more common as clinical cases. For every one clinical cases, there are 1,000 subclinical cases. in children and 75 in adults. So that is the ratio. So what is the ratio of clinical and subclinical case? One case, there are either 1,000 in children subclinical case or 75 in adults. So this ratio is in children and this ratio is in adults. You should know it. Done. So that is the thing. Period of communicability, 7 days before to 7 days after the onset of the symptoms. So if the person is having paralysis in polio, the patient is having paralysis now. So 7 days before it and 7 days after it, the person is infective. He will spread the virus to others, either through droplet infection or fecal route, by two route. The person will spread infection to others. So polio can occur from one person to another. None. So that is the period of communicability. Incubation period is 7 to 14 days. So you should know all the things. Now pathogenesis. Listen, see this diagram. I will draw also. So virus is entering via mouth. Virus is entering via mouth, either by contaminated food and contaminated water from the feces of the infected person, or by droplet infection. So virus is entering via mouth. So this is the virus going inside. First, it will go to the tonsils and cervical lymph nodes. It will multiply there. Or if it is not going there, it will go to the intestine. The virus is going to the intestine. In the intestine, we have pair patches, you know. So virus will multiply in the pair patches. So that is known as primary multiplication. So primary multiplication, virus is ingested, either ingested or inhaled. You know, if it is ingested, it is through contaminated food and it is inhaled through droplet. So first it will go to the lymphoid tissue, either the tonsil lymphoid tissue here or in the pair patches of the small intestine. This is known as primary multiplication of the virus. After that, it will come in the blood from the cervical lymph node, from the mesenteric lymph node. Then it will come in the blood. The virus is coming in the heart, in the blood. This is known as primary viremia. From here, it will go to all tissues. But specifically, it has propensity for CNS. It has propensity for affecting CNS, brain, CNS. So it will go to brain. Done. So first, it will go to the tonsil, pair patches, then regional lymph node, then bloodstream. This is known as primary viremia. After that, it will go to the CNS. In CNS, it typically affects lower motor neurons. In the lower motor neurons, it typically affects anterior or ventral horn of the spinal cord, which contains lower motor neuron. Can you see, this is spinal cord, this is spinal cord. So in the spinal cord, can you see, this is ventral horn. In the ventral horn of the spinal cord, that is anterior horn, lower motor neurons are present. It will affect that neuron. So that very specificity is there. So it will affect this, it will go to the CNS, it will go to the spinal cord. In the spinal cord, it will affect anterior horn cells of the spinal cord, affecting element there and causing secondary. Then again, it will come in blood, causing secondary viremia, and patient will have symptoms. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Give me a thumbs up. I'm teaching you polio. So this is how polio is occurring. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So polio enters either via food or via droplet. So first it goes to the tonsils, then cervical lymph node, or else it will go to the intestine. In the intestine, it will go to the pair patches. Then it will come to the blood, causing primary viremia. From the blood, it will go to the spinal cord. In the spinal cord, it will go to the ventral horn or anterior horn. It will affect element there. It will affect lower motor neuron there. And because of affection, it will destroy lower motor neuron. So patient will have paralysis. Patient will present with paralysis. That is the thing. And again, it will come in the blood. That is known as secondary viremia. So this is how polio occurs. It causes paralysis. Have you got it? What are the clinical features of polio? Who will tell me what are the clinical features of polio? So period of communicability, I told you. So when the patient is having paralysis, this is a patient, he is having the symptoms. That is, paralysis is the symptom. So 7 days before it and 7 days after it, he is communicable. The patient is communicable. He is spreading infection to others. So whenever he is having paralysis, he is not knowing that he is having polio infection. So before that only, he is spreading infection to others. So 7 days before to 7 days after. So you can learn like this. So 7 to 14 days before and 7 to 14 days after the onset of symptoms. And incubation period is also 7 to 14 days. Now, if a person is exposed to polio virus, there can be four possibilities. It is not necessary that always paralysis occur. It is very rare that after polio virus enters human body, it causes paralysis. It is only 0.1% chance. Mostly, it causes inapparent or subclinical infection in 95% of the cases. It causes subclinical infection. Rarely, it causes minor illness, Sometimes it causes non-paralytic polio and sometimes it causes paralytic polio. So there are four scenarios. We will discuss all of them. This is the diagram of all four scenarios. I will explain you. So first scenario is inapparent or subclinical infection. So 95% of the population in which polio virus is entering inside the human body, it is not causing paralysis. It is causing inapparent subclinical infection. Even the patient doesn't know that he is having polio virus from inside the body. There is no symptoms. There is no symptoms. But if you take the stool, you can find the virus is present in the feces. It is present in the stool sample. Or if you take the blood sample of that person, you will find antibodies against the virus. Then only you will come to know that this person is having subclinical infection. Otherwise, the patient is having no symptoms. He is absolutely all right. So can you see 95% of the patients is having subclinical infection, no symptoms, no symptoms. Yeah, but you can find virus in blood, virus in the throat, virus in the feces. If you see the virus in blood is shortest. It remains there only for 5 days. Virus in throat remains for 15 days. Can you see? And virus in feces remains for nearly 3 weeks, 21 days. Have you got it? So in blood, only 5 days. In throat for 15 days. And in feces, it is the longest. So you can find virus in the feces of the infected person. And if you see the blood of that person and check for antibodies, you can find the antibodies against the virus. These are the neutralizing antibodies. Antibodies are a little bit later. They start appearing after 5 days and they remain there for lifelong. So two types of antibodies are formed. We know IgM and IgG. So IgM are recent. IgG will persist for life. Have you got it? So this is the most common presentation, that is subclinical infection. Patient will not have even a single symptom. Rather, it may happen that me or you or any of us, we all are healthy. We don't have polio, I guess, right? So we have this infection in our childhood when we were 6 months to 3 years old. In our childhood, we may have this infection because it is very common, but it is subclinical. So it is 95% times it is subclinical. So many of our kids, children are having this infection, but there is no symptom. How we come to know that they are infected? Only if we check the virus either in the blood or in the throat or in the stool sample. Or we check antibodies against the virus in the blood. Then we will come to know that he is infected, but there is no symptoms. It is subclinical. I hope you got it. Second presentation is minor illness, or it is known as abortive polio. Minor ka matlab abortive, you know, minor abortive polio. Done. It present in 4 to 8% of the cases. The next, this is 95%. Next 4 to 8% will have only minor illness. No paralysis. In minor illness, what they will have? They will have a little bit of fever due to viremia and self-limiting fever, nothing else. Little bit of fever, nothing else. Recovery is very quick. You will find virus again in the three things. One in the blood, virus is present, but only for 5 days. One in the throat, virus is present for 15 days. And in feces, virus is present for 21 days. And you will find antibodies in the blood for lifelong. Lifelong antibodies will be present. Have you got it? And patient will have little bit fever, nothing else. So it is the presentation in 4 to 8% of the population. That is known as minor illness or abortive polio. Can you see here? Okay, see here. I will mark it for you. This was 91 to 96%. It was subclinical. There were no symptoms. This is abortive infection. In abortive, there is minor infection. Minor fever, but no paralysis. Have you got it? No paralysis. Coming on the third presentation. Okay, one by one. It is non-paralytic polio. It is known as aseptic meningitis. It is not causing paralysis. It is causing meningitis only. So only 1% of the infection is like this. Okay, I will show you here. The next 1% of the infection. Can you see here? Okay, I will mark with red color. So can you see here? Patient is having major illness. That is meningitis is there. So patient, only 1% of the patient have this type of infection. They have stiffness and pain in the neck. Stiffness and pain in the neck due to meningitis. The disease lasts for 2 to 10 days. But again, recovery happens. It is aseptic meningitis, that is viral meningitis. There is no paralysis. So again, there is no paralysis. Have you got it? That is the third. And the last one is the deadly, that is paralytic polio. In paralytic polio, it is only 0.1%. It is only 0.1% in which patient will have paralysis. Patient will have paralysis. So only less than 1% of the patients. So if polio virus is entering in 100 patients, the 95 will have subclinical. Next 4% of the patient will have abortive polio, that is minor fever, bagheera. 1% will have meningitis and 0.1% will have paralysis. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. So this is subclinical infection. This is abortive polio. This is abortive polio. This is meningitis. This is meningitis. And this is paralysis. This is paralysis. Give me a thumbs up. So that is the presentation out of 100. So here, paralysis occurs. If I say polio occurs, you imagine only paralysis. It is not that way. It is only in 0.1%. Rest of them, it is subclinical or abortive or meningitis. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. So in only less than 1% of the population out of 100, the polio may paralysis is occurring. Now tell me the properties of paralysis. The paralysis is flaccid. It is asymmetrical. It is known as AFP, asymmetric flaccid paralysis. So polio causes AFP, that is asymmetric flaccid paralysis in 0.1% of the population. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. In these cases, in these 0.1% of the cases, the virus is actually going in the CNS and it is entering in the spinal cord. In the spinal cord, in the ventral horn, it is destroying LMN, lower motor neurons. That's why causing paralysis. And a history of fever is always there. Along with it, patient have malaise, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, headache, sore throat, constipation, abdominal pain. These symptoms are also there along with paralysis. So patient presents with paralysis. Can you see? The patient presents with paralysis. Patient presents with asymmetric flaccid paralysis. Done. So yeah, there is a sign known as tripod sign. What do you mean by tripod sign? Patient cannot sit properly. While sitting, he assists sitting via two hands on the bed or on the floor. So it is a tripod. Can you see the two hands on the floor and patient hip is there? So it is known as tripod sign. Can you see it is two hands on the floor and this is tripod sign. Give me a thumbs up. So what is tripod sign? There, the child find difficulty in sitting and sits by supporting the hands at the back and partially flexing the hip. Can you see? It is partially flexing the hip. The hip is partially flexed. Done. So partially, so this is like this. So the two hands at the back and a partially flexed hip. So it is the tripod sign of the child. Have you got it? Let me try. Okay. So it is like this. That is tripod sign. Give me a thumbs up. Now some properties of paralysis. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Come on. The paralysis in polio is descending. It is asymmetric. What do you mean by descending? What do you mean by asymmetric? Explain it. Descending means kya? The paralysis starts at the hip, then moves to the distal part of the extremity. So paralysis is starting from here, from the hip muscles. First hip muscles will not function, then thigh muscles will not function, then this. So it is descending. It is descending. So it is descending in nature. So paralysis is descending. First, it starts from the hips and go to the distal part of the body. So paralysis is descending in nature. Have you got it? Number one. And number two, it is asymmetric. What do you mean by asymmetric? Proximal muscles are more paralyzed as compared to distal muscles. Now, what are proximal muscles? Proximal to the hip. So these muscles are more paralyzed as compared to these muscles. So it is asymmetric. It is not uniform that all the muscles are similarly paralyzed. So these muscles are more paralyzed as compared to these muscles. Give me a thumbs up. So paralysis is descending and paralysis is asymmetrical. Paralysis involves only motor neurons. There is no sensory loss. If you touch these patients anywhere in the paralyzed portion, anywhere on the legs, thigh, hip, they can feel the sensation. They can feel the vibration. They can feel hot. They can feel cold. They can feel the temperature. Sensations are normal. The sensation loss is not there. So there is no sensory loss. Sensory loss is absolutely normal. Only motor neurons are gone. Sensory neurons are not gone. Have you got it? And deep tendon reflexes are diminished. Deep tendon reflexes are diminished due to paralysis. Have you got it? DTRR gone. Done. If the person is paralyzed, person will not use the muscle. Na? For a longer time, person will not use the muscle because he is paralyzed. So atrophy of the muscles will occur after many years. Can you see atrophy here? Please appreciate atrophy. Atrophy of this leg as compared to this. So it is atrophied. Can you see it is atrophied? Atrophied. Have you got it? So atrophy of the affected muscles occur. Death can occur due to respiratory muscles paralysis. Sometimes respiratory muscle paralysis will take place and death can occur in the child. Give me a thumbs up. That is the cause of the death. So what we have learned till now? So what is the paralysis? There is a paralysis in polio. We all know. Tell me the properties of paralysis. I will tell you 7 properties of paralysis. Paralysis is descending. Give me a thumbs up at each property. Do you know the meaning of descending? Yes or no? Descending means it is starting from the hip and going downwards till the foot. It is asymmetric. Means proximal muscles are more involved than distal. That is, proximal muscles are more involved than distal. There is no sensory disturbance. Sensory function is absolutely normal. There is no autonomic disturbance. There are three things, na, sensory, motor, and autonomic. Three type of neurons are there. So only motor neurons are gone. Sensory involvement, there is no sensory involvement. There is no autonomic involvement. Only LMN, lower motor neuron type of paralysis is there, and it is non-progressive. It is not progressing ahead. It is non-progressive. One time it will occur, and it will remain there for the lifelong. The same. It is not progressive ki daily it is increasing. So it is non-progressive. Have you got it? What is the most common muscle affected? Name the most common muscle affected in this paralysis. It is quadriceps. Very important MCQ. Very important. So the most important muscle affected is quadriceps. Can you see here? This is quadriceps, na? This is quadriceps. That is most commonly muscle affected here. So most commonly muscle affected is quadriceps, but it is partial paralysis. It is not complete paralysis. Most common muscle which undergo complete paralysis is tibialis anterior. यहाँ पे होती है ये tibialis anterior. So tibial is anterior, anterior to the tibia, that undergo complete paralysis. And most common muscle affected in hand, it is known as opponensis pollicis. So in the thumb of the hand, you know, in the hand, in the thumb, it is opponensis pollicis. Everyone give me a thumbs up. MCQ can come on any point. You should know everything. Most common muscle affected, most common muscle affected showing complete paralysis, most common muscle affected in the hand. So these are the three important MCQs based on muscle. And these all are the properties of paralysis. You should know everything. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I tried hard. I tried hard. Okay. Risk of paralysis is increased if the child undergone tonsillectomy recently due to the drop in immunity, tooth extraction, adenoidectomy, again due to drop in immunity, strenuous physical exercise, or steroid administration due to any reason. If polio virus is entering in the body of the child, in the blood of the child at this time, then there are more chances that it will present with paralysis. That is only less than 0.1% of the patient present with paralysis. So these are the risk factor of the paralysis. Have you got it? So we have learned this till now. What we have learned? There are four type of presentation: inapparent or subclinical, abortive polio, non-paralytic polio, and paralytic polio. 95%, 4%, 1%, 0.1%. So you know each of them. So inapparent, there are no symptoms. Only we find virus by isolation in the stool, in the feces, or we find antibody. Here we find self-limiting illness, that is mild fever, and here we find aseptic meningitis, that is pain in the neck. And in paralysis, paralytic polio, we find descending asymmetric flaccid paralysis. It is known as asymmetric flaccid paralysis, which is of descending nature. So descending AFP. Have you got it? So we have completed this portion till now. Now tell me the lab diagnosis. How we do the lab diagnosis of poliovirus? Who will tell me how we do the lab diagnosis? What are the specimen? If we are suspecting this person is having polio, what specimen you will collect for diagnosing of the virus? There can be three specimens. If the person is live, person is living, you can take the feces. It is present throughout the course till 21 days. It is present in feces. Or you can take the throat washing, pharyngeal washing, that is throat swab. For the first 3 to 5 days, it is present in throat swab also. If the person is dead, from the autopsy specimen, directly take the spinal cord. So in the ventral horn of the spinal cord, you can find the virus. So in the dead person, you can take brain or spinal cord. And in living person, you can take feces and throat swab. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Give me a thumbs up. Now, what things you can do for lab diagnosis? You can do three things. Number one, direct demonstration of the virus. Direct microscopy. You see, you take the specimen, either it is feces or pharyngeal washing or spinal cord. You take the specimen, make a slide of it, and see it under electron microscope. You will see the virus directly. That is direct demonstration. Very easy. Number two, isolation of the virus. You culture the virus over a live cells. These are the live culture cells, cell lines. So you grow the virus on cell lines. So it can be found in feces for up to 8 weeks, and in the first 2 weeks, it is maximum present in the feces, and you can grow it on it. And the third is serology. In the blood, you will find antibodies against the virus. So what are the three ways? What are the three ways of diagnosing the polio virus? So diagnosis, how you do the diagnosis? What are the three specimens you can take? You can take three specimens. Number one, feces. Number two, throat swab or pharyngeal washing, one and the same thing. And number three, spinal cord. Brain or spinal cord after death in the autopsy. Living with them, spinal cord you cannot take. So these are the three specimens. After taking one of the specimen, any of the specimen, you can do direct microscopy. You can directly see the virus under electron microscope. Or you can do the culture tissue culture on the culture plates, cell lines, that you can do. Or number three, you can do the serology. In serology, you will take the blood and you will find antibodies against the virus. You will not search for virus, you will find antibodies against the virus. Have you got it? These are three ways of diagnosis. So you should know three specimen and three ways of diagnosing. Should I proceed? Okay. Okay. So, what about treatment? There is no specific treatment for polio, only nursing and physiotherapy. So you have to give physiotherapy and nursing only. That is the only treatment. There is no specific treatment. What is the prophylaxis? Treatment is not available, but prophylaxis is available. So prevention is always better than cure. So for prophylaxis, we have vaccine. Vaccines are available for prevention of polio, for prophylaxis of polio. Two types of vaccines are available in the market: killed vaccine and live attenuated vaccine. Killed vaccine is discovered by a scientist known as Salk. That's why known as Salk. Live vaccine is discovered by a scientist known as Sabin, known as Sabin vaccine. L, Salk contains L and killed contains L. So don't get confused. This is how I remember. Salk and Sabin both are from Aetna, so I get confused sometimes. So Salk ka spelling contains L and killed ka spelling also contains L. So killed is Salk and live is Sabin. That is how you can learn. That is how you can learn. So two types of vaccine are there. In killed vaccine, the virus is given via injection. So via intramuscular or subcutaneous injection, we will inject the virus directly in the blood. So dead virus, it is a killed virus, killed polio virus, we will inject the virus directly in the blood. That is a killed virus via intramuscular or subcutaneous injection. So after going in the blood, body will form antibodies against the virus. So it is producing humoral immunity. So killed vaccine is giving us that antibody will remain in the blood forever or lifelong. So we all are having, I guess, this injection during our childhood. So we all are having these antibodies in our blood. So whenever virus will enter inside our body, antibodies are already present and it will not cause polio or paralysis inside human body. It is due to humoral immunity. Have you got it? Have you got it? Live vaccine. Live vaccine is given by oral route. Do boom, two drops. Two drops of oral route, you know, two drops. So it is not going directly in blood. First, it is going in intestine. If it is given in the mouth, the two drops, it will go first in intestine. From intestine, it will go to the blood. From intestine, it will go to the blood, right? The killed one was directly going in the blood. Live one first going in the intestine, then going in the blood. Yes or no? Common sense. No, what I want to say, when it will go, the live is there, the virus is live, but it is attenuated. It is not pathogenic. It cannot cause infection. It cannot cause polio. But it is live. It is live. So intestine will form IgA antibodies against the virus. And blood will also form IgM and IgG antibodies against the virus. So here we get two immunities. This is known as local immunity of the intestine. And in the blood is known as humoral immunity. So here we get local as well as humoral both immunity. Via in killed, as contrast to in killed, we get only humoral immunity. Have you got it? Have you got it? So next time, have you got it? Okay, I will explain again. Give me a thumbs up if you have any doubt. So there are two types of vaccine. Killed vaccine, that is Salk, or live attenuated vaccine, that is known as Sabin. Salk and Sabin, the two types of vaccine are there. So Salk is killed, it is given by IM, intramuscular or subcutaneous route. So it will directly go in the blood. If you give the injection to the child, it will go in the blood. After going in the blood, it is a killed virus. It is killed virus, body will form antibodies against it. This is known as humoral immunity. Humoral, and antibody will remain forever. So if natural virus, wild virus is entering, antibodies are present and it will not cause paralysis. In live one, the virus is entering via oral route, two drops of the virus. It contains live virus. So first it will go in the intestine. After that, it will be absorbed in the blood. So in intestine, it will form IgA antibodies and in blood, it will form IgG. Here directly IgG are formed. So here two types of immunity is there. The first is local immunity and the second is humoral immunity. So in live vaccine, we get two immunity. That is an advantage of live over the killed. Have you got it? Have you got it? So next time, if the virus, wild virus is entering, there are two childs. This is child A, this is child B. This is given killed vaccine, this is given live vaccine. Child A is having only humoral immunity. Child B is having local as well as humoral immunity. So if virus is entering both child, this is a virus, the virus is entering inside this body also, inside this body also. So in child A, virus always enters via contaminated food, water. So it will enter via oral route. So virus will go in the intestine. So since this child do not have immunity, local immunity in the intestine, so he will have a minor infection of the intestine. He will have, but he will not have paralysis because he is having humoral immunity. So paralysis to kisi mein bhi nahi hoga, lekin isme local infection ho sakta hai, isme local bhi nahi hoga. That is my point. Have you got it? That is the thing. So that you can see the two type of vaccines are in front of you. So OPV, oral polio vaccine, and killed wala is known as IPV, inactivated polio vaccine, IPV. OPV mein you are giving vaccine by oral route. IPV mein you are giving it via injection. You see here, it is oral. You are giving it orally. So it will first go in the intestine. And here you are giving it IM. So first directly it will go in the blood. Here it will go in intestine, then it will go in the blood. Have you got it? So this is OPV, this is IPV. Give me a thumbs up. So the two types of vaccine, OPV, Sabin, and IPV is SARC. IPV is the killed one. Done. So you should know the differences between them. So OPV is live but attenuated, and IPV is killed. Killing is done in formalin. How we kill the virus? We kill the virus in formalin. That's why it is known as killed formalized virus. Here it is given via oral route, two drops. You can see two drops. Always it is given in the form of two drops. Do boon zindagi ki. It is the, you know, logo. You can say the punchline. And in IPV, it is usually intramuscular but rarely subcutaneous. So it is intramuscular or subcutaneous route. That is IPV. Here I have explained you, in OPV you will get humoral as well as local. Humoral means blood immunity and intestinal, because from mouth it will first go to the intestine, then go to the blood. So it will provide both immunity. But in IPV you will get only humoral immunity because it is directly going in the blood. So we have understood it. So here in OPV we get prevention of paralysis. Humoral immunity give prevention of paralysis, and intestinal immunity, that is IgA, will give prevention of intestinal reinfection also. So prevention of both things. And in IPV we get prevention only of paralysis. Paralysis hi main hai, minor infection ho sakta hai yahan pe, but paralysis nahi hoga. Have you got it? Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. This table is really very important, not only in microbiology, not only in pathology, but in PSM also. You have to learn this table by heart. Many MCQs are framed here. The two type of vaccines are in front of you. This is oral, this is IPV, that is injectable. Done. In epidemic, which is more useful? In epidemic, oral is more useful. IPV is not useful in epidemics. Why? Because giving injection in an epidemic is really difficult. But orally, suppose two drops dena is easy. And injection can precipitate the paralysis. So we don't take the risk. In epidemics, we give oral. We do not give IPV, injectable. Manufacture. Now listen, which is better? Who will tell me which is better, OPV or IPV? No, we cannot say it straightforward, because some features are advantages of OPV and some are advantages of IPV. Okay, I will tell you both. Let me talk about good things of OPV. OPV is easy to manufacture and it is cheaper. These two things are good. These two things are good. These two things are bad here. It is difficult to manufacture IPV and it is expensive also. It is expensive also. But here OPV requires -4 to -8 degrees Celsius. It is 4 to 8. So it is sub-zero, nearly 0 degrees temperature. So you cannot carry it in hand. You have to carry it in a cold box. You have to always keep it in refrigerator. So storage and transport is very difficult. There is a stringent condition for storage and transport. You have to maintain the temperature 4 to 8 degrees Celsius. And here you can carry it at room temperature also. So this is the advantage here. Shelf life is very short. Here shelf life is long. Again, advantage of IPV. And VAPP can occur here in OPV. In OPV, the virus is live na. Sometimes attenuation achhe se nahi ho paya. So virus is pathogenic also and live also. So by giving vaccine, the child can develop paralysis. The child will develop paralysis. Now we are giving vaccine to the child to prevent paralysis. But instead of it, because of vaccine, child develop paralysis. It happens 4 cases in India. It happens 1 per million case. There is a rare chance, but chance is always there. So there is always a risk. Now, 1 million mein se wo ek child ko hi bhi ho sakta hai. Any child can happen. And it can happen in any child. So it is known as vaccine-associated paralytic polio, VAPP. It is not due to wild virus. It is due to the virus present in the vaccine. No, virus is attenuated, but it is not fully attenuated. And virus is live, so it can cause paralysis. Now in the virus, there are three proteins, na? P1, P2 and P3. In the initial of the lecture, I have taught you. It is P3 which is causing VAPP. So VAPP is always a chance, a risk there. But in IPV, there is zero chances of VAPP because virus is killed. Killed virus cannot cause disease. So there is no chance. So there are some advantages here and disadvantages here, and there are some advantages here, disadvantages here. You should know each of them. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. इसके एडवांटेज क्या हैं, डिसएडवांटेज क्या हैं? ऊपर से इसके जो एडवांटेज हैं वो इसके डिसएडवांटेज हैं, इसके जो डिसएडवांटेज हैं वो इसके एडवांटेज हैं. सो यू शुड नो दिस कंपैरेटिव टेबल. एवरीवन गिव मी अ थम्स अप. हैव यू गॉट इट? ओके, लिटिल बिट मोर डिटेल अबाउट दैम. लेट मी टॉक अबाउट द फर्स्ट वन, इनएक्टिवेटेड वन, आईपीवी. आईपीवी दैट इज सार्क. सार्क, सो इट वॉज डिस्कवर्ड बाय सार्क, दैट्स वाई नोन एज सार्क वैक्सीन. सो इट इज डिस्कवर्ड इन 1953. इट इज अ किल्ड वैक्सीन. वी नो इट इज मेड फ्रॉम वाइल्ड पोलियो वायरस. Wild polio virus is inactivated or killed by formalin. So we take wild polio virus and we kill the virus by putting it in formalin. So by putting it in formalin, the virus is killed. And there are three strains: Mehoni, MEF1, or Southkit. These are the three: Sark type 1, Sark type 2. So there are three strains which are used universally. These are the name of the. Now, what is the schedule of IPV? We are studying IPV. What is the schedule? You have to give the injections, of course. You have to give the injection. How many injection and when? So what is the schedule? Total 4 doses, 4 times injection, 4 doses. So first 3 doses, 2 or 1 month apart. So this is dose 1. After 1 month, dose 2. After 1 month, dose 3. And the last dose is 6 months apart. So 1 month, 1 month, 6 months. So total 4 doses are there. So this is the schedule. Give me a thumbs up. So dose, you can see the 4 doses. And you can see the duration between them. First dose, second dose, third dose, fourth dose. So between first, second and second, third, there is 1 month gap. Between third to fourth, there is a 6 month gap. That is the schedule. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. So anyone, we can give this vaccine to anyone. But we have to give total 4 doses. That is the schedule. We can, in the infant, if we want to give, we have to start at 6 weeks. Not less than 6 weeks. Because less than 6 weeks, maternal antibodies, residual maternal antibodies are there from the mother. Mother also have the antibodies for the polio virus, na? The mother is vaccinated and giving the antibodies via placenta, and those antibodies will survive in the child after birth for 6 weeks. So after 6 weeks you give it and you start it. So all 4 doses are given after 6 weeks. So 6 weeks pe pehla doge, then 10 weeks pe doge after 1 month, then 14 weeks pe doge the third one. उसके बाद 6 months के बाद दोगे, इसके बाद 6 months पे दोगे. Have you got it? Have you got it? Then every 5 years till the age of 18, every 5 years you have to give booster because it is killed na, it is killed na. So you have to give boosters very frequently. Again, this is a disadvantage. It is killed. It is not live. It is killed. Now, if it is live, if the virus is live, you are giving live vaccine. So only one is sufficient, na? You are giving one, so virus is live. Now virus will do proliferation inside the body. So there is no need of giving boosters again and again. But it is killed. You have to give boosters again and again. Every 5 years you have to give the booster till 18 years of age. Have you got it? Have you got it? In killed, you have to give the boosters. What is the route? Preferably it is intramuscular, but rarely we can give subcutaneous also. So preferable route, you learn only one. It is intramuscular. It is intramuscular. Have you got it? There are 3 polio viruses, na? Type 1, type 2, type 3. Polio virus type 1, type 2, type 3. What is the composition of IPV? How much each of them is present? This is the old composition. So don't learn it. Improved composition. You have to learn this. So learn directly improved one. This is the modification, right? Given in PARC, latest PARC. So this is the modification. So polio type 1, type 2, type 3, all of them are present in the vaccine in the killed form. So polio type 1 polio is present 40 Dalton antigens are present. Type 2 is 8 Dalton and type 3 is 32 Dalton. So 48 and 32 Dalton antigenic units of type 1, type 2, type 3 is present in one vial. One vial. So you are injecting all three. These all are killed. Give me a thumbs up. The killing is done by formalin, by putting the virus in formalin. What are the advantages of IPV and what are the disadvantages? You tell me. I have explained you, no? You tell me. You can give it in immunodeficiency disorders also because the vaccine is killed. So there is no harm. There is no risk of giving you cannot give any live vaccine to immunocompromised person because of chances of disease, right? There is no chances of VAPP, vaccine associated poliovirus like in live virus. It is safe in pregnancy also. You can give it in pregnancy also because it is killed. No live vaccine is given during pregnancy, right? And you can give it up to the age of 50 years if the patient is not vaccinated in the childhood. And safe in person on radiotherapy, steroid therapy, immunodeficiency state. So, and it does not require stringent storage condition. You can keep it at room temperature also. No refrigerator is required. And it is having a long shelf life. So these are advantages which are disadvantages of the OPV, which are the advantages here. Disadvantages are only two. It is giving only humoral immunity. It is not giving intestinal immunity. It is giving only humoral immunity, no intestinal immunity like the live one. And it is not suitable for epidemic. So these two are disadvantages. Give me a thumbs up. So you can see here, it is longer. It has zero chances of VAPP. Less stringent conditions are required. These things are good, but two things are bad. It is expensive and manufacture is difficult. These things are bad and it is not useful in epidemic. So these things are disadvantages. These are disadvantages and these are advantages. Give me a thumbs up. No, it will happen opposite. The advantages of here will turn disadvantages here. These are the disadvantages of this and these are the advantages. So these are opposite. Advantage, disadvantage are opposite. Have you got it? What I mean? Have you got it? So coming on the second vaccine, I have already explained you, oral Sabin vaccine, OPV. It was discovered by Sabin in 1962. Yes or no? It contains live virus, but it is attenuated. It contains all three, type 1, type 2, type 3. And we create live virus on monkey kidney cells or human diploid cell cultures. So we are taking the wild virus. We are putting it here on cell lines. We are proliferating it. Then we are attenuating it. We are attenuating it so that pathogenicity is lost but immunogenicity is not lost. Now what is the composition? Here we are giving live virus, not the dead, not the killed. So type 1 type 2 type 3, type 1 is given 3 lakh unit, type 2 is 1 lakh unit and type 3 is 3 lakh. 313. And what was the composition of IPV? It is 48 and 32 Dalton. There wahan pe Dalton mein unit thi, yahan pe lakhs mein unit hai. Have you got it? You have to learn. What is the dose? It is 2 drops. 2 drops is equivalent to kya? 2 boons zindagi ki. 2 drops is equivalent to 0.1. It is equivalent to 0.1 ml. 2 drops. 2 drops are given. In 2 drops, approx 0.1 ml is given. We do not measure 0.1. Approx 2 drops are given. Root is oral. It is visible. Root is oral. Done. So in OPV, what is the schedule? When to give? So in national immunization schedule, it is OPV 0 dose. One, now as I have told you, no boosters are required, but for safety purpose we give the boosters because sometimes it is ineffective. Ideally one dose is sufficient, single dose is sufficient because it is live now, it itself will proliferate, but for safety purpose we give the booster also. So 0 dose is given at birth. As soon as the child is born, give 2 drops, number one, that is known as 0 dose. Then dose 1, dose 2, dose 3 at 6 week, 10 week, 4 week, 14 week, 1 month apart. So 1 month, 1 month, 4 weeks means 1 month ki gap pe. And booster is given at 2 years. At 2 years. Have you got it? So that is the national immunization schedule. This is the complete schedule. You can see OPV 0, OPV 1, OPV 2, OPV 3 and OPV booster. So total 5 doses are recommended. How many doses? 5 doses. So what is the schedule? I'm sorry. I hope I'm visible, no? I pressed the wrong button. Anyways. So OPV 0 dose, 1 dose, 2 dose, 3 dose, booster dose. Who will tell me? Kab dete hain? When we give, 0 is given at birth, dose 1 is given at 6 week, 2, 4 weeks after 6 weeks, that is 4, 6 plus 4, 10 week, 10 plus 4, 14 week, then at 24 weeks, that is 2 years. So that is the schedule. So total 5 doses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 0, dose 0, dose 1, dose 2, dose 3, dose booster, that is given of OPV. So learn, or what about IPV? What was for IPV? Total 4 doses are given. So first dose, second dose, third dose, fourth dose. So what is the duration between them? First and second, there is 1 month, that is 4 week. Again 1 month, that is 4 week, and 6 month. So that is the thing. If you are starting from childhood, start at 6 week. The first dose is given at 6 week, then 10 week, then 14 week, and then 6 months after that. 6 months after that, and booster is given every 5 years till 18 years of age. So many boosters are there, not a single booster. So 4 doses ke alawa many boosters. That is the schedule for IPV. Learn schedule for OPV, IPV parallel. Both of them. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. What is the mechanism of action of vaccine? How vaccine acts and prevents from paralysis? So if you are giving OPV, I'm talking about OPV. So OPV is given 2 boons. Two drops are given orally. Na? So these 2 drops contain the virus. So the virus is going orally into the intestine. So first it multiplies in the pair patches of the intestine and form IgA antibody in the intestine. Then it will go in the blood. In the blood it will form IgM and IgG antibody here. So it is providing local immunity as well as humoral immunity, and the virus is attenuated. It cannot go in the CNS and cause paralysis like the wild virus. So this is in contrast. This is for wild virus. This is same as that of wild virus, but wild virus can enter in the CNS and cause pathogenicity paralysis also. This cannot enter in CNS because it is attenuated. So it will go in the mouth. It will go via two drops in the mouth. It will go in the intestine, form IgA antibodies in the intestine. It will go in the blood, form IgG antibodies in the blood and remain there and there forever. So if in future wild virus is entering via mouth, so Ig antibodies are already present in the intestine, it will kill the wild virus. And if it enters in the blood, IgG are present there and it will kill the wild virus. So wild virus is killed and it will not cause pathogenicity. Before reaching the brain, there are two hindrances: local immunity and humoral immunity. IgA and IgG both will kill the virus. Have you got it? So double protection we are giving. Have you got it? One more advantage. So it is IgG and IgA, as I have explained you, two types of immunity. So it gives protection from the paralysis, from the wild virus. Have you got it? One more advantage. In India, we say we should give polio virus to all children present in India less than 5 years of age. So how many less than 5 years of age children are present in India? So is it necessary for eradication of the polio 100% of the children should be given the vaccine? No. If only 60% of them are given, our work is done, eradication is possible. You will say, ma'am, how? What about the rest of the 40% who are not taking the vaccination? So how eradication of the polio is possible even if we are giving vaccine only to 60% of the children? How it is possible? Because of the herd immunity. What do you mean by herd immunity? Now just suppose there are two childs in a colony, in a home. So the first child is taking the vaccination. The mother of the first child is educated and she is very aware. She is very, motivated. She is giving regularly vaccine to the child and the first child received the two drops. These are the two drops of OPV. I'm talking about OPV. So this child got OPV. The OPV gone into the intestine of this child. Then the OPV gone in the blood of this child. In the intestine, the OPV formed IgA. In the blood, it formed IgG. Okay. What after that? Some of the virus is excreted in the feces also of this child. So when we give vaccine on that day and few days after, nearly 20 days after that, the virus is excreted in the feces also. Which virus? It is a vaccine virus, not wild virus. So it is present in the feces of this child. Now this child is in close vicinity of another child. This is another child which is not vaccinated. And the feces is contaminated in the food, the water, the everything. And this food water is consumed by this child. In India, there is, because of overcrowding, less hygienic condition and poor condition, just things happen. So feces are contaminating the food, water, everything. And this is ingested by another child, which is not vaccinated. So we will consider this child is also vaccinated. Have you got it? So this is an advantage given by OPV. So in OPV, the virus is multiplying in the gut, excreted in the feces, and secondary spread to the household contacts is occurring. So that non-immunized person is considered as immunized. Give me a thumbs up, I tried hard. So this is how herd immunity is maintained. Herd immunity is coming. And even if only 66% of the children are vaccinated, 100% will be vaccinated. Because these 66, the remaining 33 which are non-vaccinated, they will get the vaccine from the feces of these 66. Give me a thumbs up, I tried hard. Done. So that is, the whole community will be immunized. That is the thing. Storage. I have told you it has to be stored at 4 to 8 degree OPV, stringent condition, 4 to 8 degree for 4 months only. And if you store at minus 20, it will be for 2 years. So stringent conditions are required. So if vaccine manufacture takes place in a factory, some factory is there. So from there, a transit storage, the whole bus or van, you can see, it has a refrigerator from inside. So transit storage takes place in that refrigerator van. Then the vaccine will reach primary vaccine store. There are cold rooms. The complete room is a refrigerator. The vaccines are stored in the cold rooms. If you have visited some cold room, it is very common. At the health center, it is stored in refrigerators. In refrigerators, not in freezer. In the freeze. Freezer mein nahi. There is a difference between freezer and freeze. So we are storing at 4 to 8 degree. Not at zero. Freezer mein temperature is less than zero. It is in minus. We don't want to keep it at minus. Done. At immunization venue, we take it in cold box. You know what are cold box? You may have seen if you have done your duties in your hospital. And then ultimately we apply. We take it from the cold box and give two drops to the patient. Two drops. If anywhere in the hold, from the manufacturer till patient, vaccine manufacturer in the factory till reaching the patient, this is known as cold chain. If cold chain is breakdown, if cold chain is broken at any place, at any place if it is not maintained, the efficacy of vaccine is gone. So there is no use of giving such vaccine to patient. It is ineffective. It is ineffective. If at any point cold chain is broken, have you got it? Have you got it? So that is the thing. So you know the advantages of OPV. It is easy to administer. It is oral, na? Two drops are very easy to given. It gives humoral as well as systemic immunity. Single dose is sufficient, but we are giving total 5, 0, 1, 2, 3 for safety, for backup, you know. And it will spread to another person, non-vaccinated person also via feces, and it is inexpensive and it is useful in controlling epidemics. But disadvantages, it is thermolabile. So cold chain is required. It is thermolabile. Cold temperature is required. So in refrigerator, we keep it here. So you should know about all vaccines, which vaccine are kept at upper compartment, middle compartment, lower compartment, which of them are kept in freezer, which of them are. So you should know all about comparative table of all vaccines. I am teaching you only two vaccines, OPV, IPV. But in PSM, you have to make a comparative table of all vaccines. There is a complication which is caused by OPV known as VAPP, vaccine associated paralytic polio. So as I have told you, if the, this is the virus, this is the vaccine, two drops of vaccine, two drops I am giving. So the virus is going in the mouth of the child, in the intestine. From the intestine, it will go to the blood and it will form IgG antibodies and IgA antibodies in the blood. But virus is attenuated, so it cannot enter in CNS. It cannot enter from the blood, it cannot enter in the CNS. But if attenuation is not proper due to anything, virus attenuation is less and it is live, na? It is a live vaccine. So virus will enter in the CNS, and because of this vaccine, patient will develop paralysis. So patient is developing paralysis not from wild virus. It is developing paralysis from vaccine virus. So it is known as VAPP. That is vaccine associated paralytic polio. It is a deadly, you know, imagine a child. Imagine some of your known child. He is taking vaccine, two drops of the polio, and he is developing polio because of the vaccine. So how tragic it is, na? How tragic. He is taking vaccine. That's why he is having polio. So who will answer for it? Who is answerable for it? So vaccine, so imagine the condition. So, you know, so who can have, okay, imagine one more deadly condition. The person who is taking the vaccine, usko bhi paralysis ho to samajhta hai. But the person who is taking the vaccine, he is excreting virus in the feces. And another child who is not taking vaccine, usme ye jaake paralysis kara hai to ye bhi ho sakta hai, wo to aur poor child hoga. So recipient of the vaccine and the context of this child. So it is 1 per million, 1 per million risk is 1 per million. That is VAPP. Done. So child can develop polio because of vaccine also. So that is vaccine associated. Contraindication, don't give any live vaccine to immunocompromised person, to leukemia person, malignancy, AIDS, steroid, pregnancy. It is for all live vaccine. Never give any live vaccine to this population. So never give it. And yeah, there is one more thing, last thing, vaccine vial monitor, VVM. So we have a pulse polio immunization program, PPI, pulse polio immunization program, which was launched in 1988. So we have put VVM in that. What do you mean by VVM? VVM are the labels on the bottles of this vaccine. Now, if my child, just suppose my child is getting vaccine, so two drops are given, he's a healthcare provider, he is giving vaccine to my child. Now I am concerned whether the cold chain is maintained or not. If the cold chain is broken at any point from the manufacturer till the mouth of my child, the vaccine is ineffective. This vaccine, there is no use of giving this vaccine. So I am asking the healthcare provider whether the vaccine is effective or not. How I am assured that you have maintained the cold chain throughout the cycle from the factory till the mouth of my child. The entire cold chain is maintained. So there is a label present. There is a label present on the, can you see the label? Label has a, this label is known as VVM, vaccine vial monitor. Vaccine vial monitoring. You can do the monitoring. So outer circle and inner square. So there is an outer circle and inner square. Outer circle is always blue color. It is always blue color, outer circle. Inner square is white color. If it is white color, it is effective. It is effective. Inner square is made up of a substance which is thermolabile. So if temperature is maintained, it will remain white only. If it is not maintained, it will change the color. So it will become blue. It will become more blue, as same as that of the outer circle. And it will become darker, even darker than the outer circle. So this is known as grade 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 grading of the vial is there. So see this diagram. Here in the first diagram, see, it is white color. Here it is light blue. Here it is same as that of outer circle, and here it is darker than that of outer circle. So you can, that is the best vaccine can be given. This also can be considered, but less effective. These two vaccines cannot be given to the child, discard them. They are ineffective now because you have not maintained the cold chain. So that is the thing. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. This is known as VVM. VVM. VVM has four grading. So there is an outer circle, there is a white square inside it, which changes color because it is made up of a material which is thermolabile. So that is the thing. Vaccine should be considered ineffective if it is, if the color of the inner square is equivalent or darker than the outer. If it is lighter than the outer, you can use it. That is a general rule. So you have to teach your healthcare provider this. So before giving vaccine to any child, he can be the Anganwadi worker, she can be Asha. So you have to train them that before giving it to the mouth of the child, two drops, check this VVM. If it is okay, then only give. So can you see this VVM here? Can you see the inner square? It is still lighter. It is grade 2. So this is like this. Have you got it? So outer circle, inner square. Can you see inner square? Outer circle is always blue. So it is the marker of potency. It is the marker of potency. So only inner circle changes the color because it is made up of a material. Outer is always blue. Inner is white, light blue, same blue as that of outer circle, and become dark black. So in the first two condition it can be used, in the next two condition it cannot be used. So grade 1, grade 2 can be used, grade 3, grade 4 cannot be. Grade 3 is the discard point. Grade 3 is the discard point. Give me a thumbs up. Grade 3 is the discard point. So based on VVM, OPV is stable up to grade 2 and grade 3 is the discard point. Done. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. So I am done. I guess I am done. Pulse polio immunization, you can read by yourself. It is given here. Two rounds always given. What is the schedule? What is the mop-up activity? So I have to stop here. I have to stop your rabies virus. I will take in the tomorrow's session, I guess. Just give me 1 second. So just after 10 minutes, my next lecture is there. So I'm ending this streaming. I'm ending this lecture. Just after 10 minutes, I'm having another live lecture of pharmacology. I'm having the lecture at 10:15 sharp, just after 10 minutes. Join me for pharma. In pharma, I'm going to teach you anti-malarial drugs. Don't dare to miss it. I'm ending the streaming. See you. Bye-bye. Join that link of pharmacology anti-malarial drugs.